Welcome back. This is Dr. Jin Sung, where clinical excellence meets excellent results. Today, we're going to talk about anxiety. These four things you can do to help reduce anxiety almost immediately, and is free and effective. So let's get right into it. Anxiety, do these four things. Listen to music, okay? You want to listen to music that has 60 beats per minute for 3 to 4 minutes. Followed immediately by music that has 50 beats per minute for 3 to 4 minutes. So let's say you do a total of 8 minutes. In the beginning, you want to do 60 beats per minute and then 50 beats per minute thereafter. What that does is it decreases your heart rate, it'll decrease your blood pressure, and it'll start to decrease your stress hormones. Now, a lot of runners will also use beat music when they run on a pace. So they want to maintain a certain pace throughout a run. So they'll use music to pace themselves, okay? Number two is breathing. Deep belly breathing. So not the breathing where you're opening up your chest wall and go, we don't want that. What you want to do is breathe deep, but push your stomach out and your diaphragm down, right? We don't want to have this type of movement. We want to have that belly stick out and the diaphragm pushing down. So you deep belly breathe for 4 seconds. So you breathe in 4 seconds deeply, followed by 6 second hold, and then breathe slowly out for 8 seconds. Okay, so 4 second breathing in, 6 second hold, 8 second out. Now you can do this in any other ratio. You can do 3, 5, and 7. You can do 5, 7, and 9. However you want to do it. And you're going to have to work your way up in terms of the number of seconds you can hold it. But you can start low. You can do 2, 4, and 6 if you want. But you want to do that for about 2 minutes in a very slow, rhythmic pace. It'll increase your oxygen. It'll increase your parasympathetic tone. So deep belly breathing is one way you can stimulate the vagal nervous system. I have a separate video on the vagus nerve, so you want to watch that. I made it about constipation, but it also works very well for anxiety. I'll link that video below. Vigorous exercise. You want to exercise for 30 to 45 minutes very vigorously, and that will increase your brain-derived neurotrophic factor. It'll increase your dopamine levels and your endorphins, which is your happy high hormones, human growth hormones, and in men, it will also increase testosterone levels. So these three things in itself will decrease anxiety. And the fourth one is grounding. Grounding is basically kind of meditative, but what you want to do is take off your shoes, go barefoot, and walk on dirt or grass for maybe 10 to 15 minutes a day. So the grounding aspect will kind of balance your body's frequencies with the Earth's frequency, which is the Schumann frequency of 7.83 hertz. So grounding has profound effects on people also in terms of rest and relaxation. Now, number five is optional, it's supplementation. You can use B vitamins. You can use magnesium, valerian root extract, passion flower extract, L-theanine, and lithium orotate. So I have a separate video on these supplements on anxiety, and I'll link that below. But essentially, you can do things for free and see how it works. If you do the first four things and do it consistently for a week, your anxiety levels should go down. The fastest way to reduce stress. The physiological sigh. What is it? What does it do? And how can we improve our stress levels very quickly? So let's get right into it. The physiological sigh is basically a double inhale followed by a long exhale. So this is how it's done. You go. Basically, you take a deep inhale through the nose. And when you're done, you take a little bit more in and then followed by a long exhale, okay? What does that do? It forces air into the alveoli, or the sacs of the lung, okay? And basically people usually think about the lung as just like a balloon, but it's like a balloon, but it has these little areas that need to open up called the alveoli. So when we go through different stressful moments and not breathing correctly, not exercising, and not doing the things that we should do, some of these sacs don't inflate, or it's not as efficient as it should be. And doing that extra inhale will open up the lung sacs or the alveoli, okay? When you lay down the sacs or the alveoli on the ground, it's about 50 to 140 square meters. The singles tennis court is approximately 195.71 square meters, all right? So it's approximately the size of a tennis court. What it does is it offloads maximum carbon dioxide from our system to be able to double inhale. During inhalation, the heart rate actually increases. So when you do this, the diaphragm contracts and goes down. The thoracic cavity, okay, actually increases in size. When that happens, the heart temporarily will increase in size, increasing volume in the heart. That itself will send a signal. So the thoracic cavity will increase in size, increase heart volume, and then sends a signal to the brain going, oh, wait a minute, we need to increase our heart rate. So the brain sends a signal back to the heart and goes, increase the heart rate. So the inhalation portion actually increases heart rate. The exhalation or exhale of your breath decreases the heart rate by decreasing the thoracic size cavity, decreasing the heart volume, sending the signal, and the brain goes, oh, let me decrease the heart rate, all right? So that's how it works. The two inhales might temporarily increase your heart rate, but the long exhale will decrease your heart rate and will have a parasympathetic response over time. So the diaphragm is innervated by the phrenic nerve. That comes from the cervical spine in the neck, cervical number 3, 4, and 5, okay? And that innervates almost all of the diaphragm, except there's a part called the crust of the diaphragm, which is innervated by the vagus nerve. And the vagus nerve innervates a lot of our organs, and the vagus nerve has a parasympathetic response. So by increasing the movement of that diaphragm, you're actually stimulating the vagus nerve, having a parasympathetic or a calming effect in our system, okay? Now, this idea of the physiological sigh comes from Dr. Jack Fellman, and he took the work from other scientists back in the 1930s, but he really expanded on it. And Dr. Andrew Huberman actually made it very popular. So people are getting to really understand this because of Dr. Huberman's work and his podcast. I'll link his podcast below in the description. All right, so let's talk about this one more time. How do we do this? It only takes 1 to 3 physiological sighs, right? That repetition. So one deep inhale followed by a short inhale, right, through the nose. You want to inhale through the nose. So a deep inhale followed by a short inhale right at the end, just to increase the or open up the alveoli of the lungs. And you want to do that through the nose, followed by a long exhale through the mouth. Okay, that's basically one cycle. You can do 1 to 3 cycles, and that's enough to reduce your stress load and calm down your heart rate, okay? And have a parasympathetic response. So inhaling through the nose will stimulate the paranasal sinuses, which also increases nitric oxide, right? So breathing through the nose stimulates nitric oxide, and nitric oxide is a vasodilator. helps to open up the blood vessels, okay, increases circulation. The exhale, if you do it with humming, will also increase nitric oxide by almost 15-fold. So the way to do this is the two deep inhales followed by a long exhale. If you want to actually increase nitric oxide during the exhale, you hum. So this, it goes like this. It goes. And you breathe all the way out. That humming, the oscillation of that humming, stimulates the paranasal nasal sinuses even further to increase nitric oxide. So the traditional way would be doing it this way, with the silent exhale. But if you want to increase nitric oxide even further, you can do the exhale with humming. Today we're going to talk about people who experience anxiety when they first wake up in the morning. And this is due to a dysfunctional cortisol awakening response. So let's get right into it. Morning cortisol awakening response, or what we call CAR. Okay? CAR. Increase of cortisol by up to 50% first thing in the morning when you get up. Approximately 20 to 30 minutes upon awakening, you're going to have what we call peak cortisol. CAR is a brain-based mechanism. The hypothalamus speaks to the suprachiasmatic nucleus and speaks to the hippocampus, which is all part of the brain. The suprachiasmatic nucleus and the hippocampus are basically the pacemaker of cortisol rhythm, your circadian rhythm. So the brain is responsible for waking you up and putting you back to sleep. Okay? So there's multiple factors that will impact this. Okay? You cannot reestablish the cortisol awakening response by taking adrenal glands, okay, or adrenal supplements. You have to be able to do a few different things in order to reestablish the cortisol awakening response. So, what are some of the signs and symptoms of a dysfunctional cortisol response? No appetite in the morning, or they will often crave sugar first thing in the morning, or coffee. Okay? They need a big cup of coffee to get started. Some people will feel anxiety and feel irritable first thing in the morning. And they must move to feel normal, meaning they feel so lethargic, right? They can't move and they just can't get out of bed. They need to start moving around for maybe 10 to 15 minutes, gets the blood flow going, and then they start to feel what we call normal. Okay? So these are some of the signs and symptoms of a dysfunctional cortisol rhythm. How do we establish the cortisol awakening response? Okay. Number one, you want to use sunrise stimulation from red to bright yellow. You can get an alarm clock or you can get these lighting mechanism with timers where the light will come on at a certain time and it will go from red to bright yellow very slowly over maybe 10 minutes or 15 minutes. And it brightens up the room. And that is what wakes you up out of a deep sleep rather than a loud alarm, okay? So you want to be able to stimulate or simulate a sunrise. The other thing is high intensity exercise within 10 minutes of awakening, right? So you want to get up, you want to do calisthenics, squats, push-ups, sit-ups, and you want to do it very aggressively for 2 to 5 minutes, depending on your capacity. So you might start at 30 seconds per day in the beginning, and then work your way up to a minute, 2 minute, 3 minute, up to 5 minute maximum. So you want to get your blood flow going. You want your cortisol response to start to reestablish within that 10 minutes of awakening. You can also use glycyrrhiza, or basically licorice root, within 10 minutes of awakening. Now, glycyrrhiza has been shown to improve the half-life of cortisol. So rather than your adrenal glands trying to produce more cortisol, glycyrrhiza will help improve the half-life of cortisol in our system. and also improves aldosterone. Okay. The caution is, if you have hypertension, you have to be cautious about using licorice root because it increases blood pressure in some people. Number four, no sugar or caffeine. Sometimes it's very tough to get through that first week or two of no caffeine, but you need to reestablish this. So no caffeine or sugar in the morning. And what you want to do is increase fats and proteins. So if you're not allergic to eggs, eggs are a great source of protein. Good fats, you can use avocado, or you can use turkey bacon. So you can use a few different things in the morning to get your first nutritious meal. No sugar in the morning, okay? Also, you wanna plan before the night before. What that means is you wanna write down the things that you have to do for the next day. So it's not on your mind. So you don't want to think about it overnight, like I have to do this, I have to do that. You want to kind of clear your mind. So a little bit of journaling first thing before bed, and then maybe first thing getting up in the morning just to jot things down. That'll clear your mind as to all the different little stressors that'll be impacting your day, all right? Another one is proper amount of quality sleep. You have to be able to sleep deeply in a good setting where you're not waking up frequently. Oftentimes, blood sugar is a part of this, so you want to manage your blood sugar. Also, if you look at your sleep cycle, it's about 90 minutes to 110 minutes. So you want to be able to sleep maybe 4 to 6 sleep cycles through the night. And ideally, you want to wake up at the end of your sleep cycle rather than right in the middle, okay? So you want to be able to plan for at least 6 to 8 or 9 hours of sleep if you're looking at the different sleep cycles. But you can use these steps to reestablish what we call the cortisol awakening response. So if you feel anxious, you want to try these methods and see if that will help you. Today we're going to talk about L-theanine. What is it? Where is it derived from? What kind of dosages can we take to derive the benefits? So L-theanine has been known to help improve stress and anxiety. It's the most abundant water-soluble non-protein amino acid found in Camellia sinensis leaves, okay? It's basically a relaxing agent. It helps to relax our minds, our bodies. A 2016 study showed different concentration of different leaves. And it showed that green tea had the highest concentration, followed by white tea, followed by oolong tea, and then black tea, right? Highest to lowest concentration. It's been found to be neuroprotective, so it helps actually has an antioxidant effect, really. Improves attention and decreases stress. So if we look at it, L-theanine, the bioavailability is pretty high, 72 to 74% bioavailability. It also crosses the blood-brain barrier. So what that means is it has a neurological and neuroprotective effect. It crosses the blood-brain barrier pretty quickly, right? Within an hour or so. Most studies use 200 to 400 milligrams per day to see if it has an impact. So there's studies on hypertension, obsessive compulsive disorders, attention deficit disorders, sleep, insomnia, and those types of things. When they did studies on it, it usually is pretty well tolerated. So they've done 400 milligrams per day for 8 weeks with really no adverse effects. So it's a pretty safe nutrient. The main uses is really anxiety, cognitive function, insomnia, which is another good one, right? Stress and relaxation. So it has all that calming or what we call parasympathetic effects to our body. Now, it's quite expensive to extract the active ingredients from the tea leaves. So to create L-theanine from natural sources and extract it from the leaves gets quite expensive and it doesn't yield a lot, although the purity is very good. Now, there are commercially available products like sun-theanine, which is a basically a chemical process to extract theanine. However, there are some concerns about using it because this L-theanine, the L version and also a D version. So there are some concerns. Although a 2006 study or 2004 study showed that it had very, very minimal amounts of the D polymer. So I would just suggest taking the green tea or oolong tea or black tea and drinking that maybe a couple hours before bed for rest and relaxation. Or if you're a highly anxious person, you can start off that way in the morning. Okay? My name is Dr. Jin Sung, where clinical excellence meets excellent results. And we'll see you guys next week on the healthy side. Have an awesome day.